Of course, there are just as much as in the city, there are places that are at the center of people's imagination, there are places that are at the center of national conversations, there are also places that are outside of those conversations, secondary or tertiary architectural landmarks, places that may have had a history in their past that really signified the future of New York, and then with time they became less important and forgotten. And we have someone here who will talk a little bit about those places and let us reimagine what they can be in the future. And with that, I would like to introduce Sarah Caples, owner of Caples Jefferson Architects in Long Island City, professor at City College in Syracuse.
I apologize for my glasses. I think of them as my zip card glasses. I'm having trouble with the light. I think this is Louis Armstrong land. And it's one of three new cultural destinations that we're working on right now. So our idea in these destinations is to make them very specific to the very local area and to the culture, and in that way reach out to a larger culture and to kind of bring people into some of the things that make New York very interesting and very a lot of variety. So the Louis Armstrong, here you can see this is the front of a museum that's across the street from his old house in Corona, Queens. So we're kind of trying to bring the music out onto the street in a building form that's sort of vaguely evocative of music. And also, at the heart of this, like all of these institutions, is an ongoing set of activities. So here's a jazz club. Whether you're 8 years old or you're a lifelong music fan, you hear not only recordings of the ghost of Louis Armstrong, but you hear live music. And so now these images are from African art. Our clients for the next destination, Weeksville Heritage Center, which is a whole sort of block end built around a Freedman's Village that was rediscovered in the 60s, but grew up in New York after emancipation in the early 19th century. And so we have a very modern building as dictated virtually by the Public Design Commission. And we're weaving these patterns back into a modern artifact. And so it's not only these sort of patterns on these kind of braiding patterns on the stone, the purple and green Vermont slate, but also these pickets of this surrounding fence, for instance, are specific sort of recollections of African art and African agricultural patterns. This first began as an agricultural community. The kind of bend and twist, and of course they're made by a modern digital laser jet cut, oh, you know, all that stuff. But here's also the entrance along an old Indian trail. So this 50-foot wide entrance uses, again, colors from West African art, the kind of ancestors at the origin of this community. And here is an entrance to the performance area. There, again, in this destination, there are many performances. The structure kind of is a three-dimensional iteration of the basket patterns. But it's not only a structure. Here you see where these patterns are, but since this is a LEED Gold building with all kinds of sunshading devices, we use the different shades of glass in this transparent pavilion to create a pattern that changes its location literally from when you come in to when you leave. So an idea of very specific visual memories embedding themselves in your mind and becoming part of the experience. And this third venue is specific, and yet also the specifics come from an enormous range of cultures. This, of course, is the site of where the aliens came in Men in Black, and is from the 1964 World's Fair. We added a pavilion, sort of a borough, a party room for the borough here for 600 people, and we tried to build on this kind of va-vome circular geometry, obviously, and we have these spiraling entrances, and this depicts the geometry and the lights. Here you can see how it's really kind of developing. And the idea for this pavilion, in part, is to announce itself to the public and for the public to feel both that they're coming to the theater and that they're in the park. So transparent and theatrical and kind of inside-outside all at the same time. And when we started this project, that inverted dome was gray, you know, it was kind of downtown hipstery, but that turned out not to really speak to the 109 different ethnic groups of Queens. So if we're going to appeal to them, we did a kind of a smattered focus group. We found that a color palette that was understood by a lot of cultures was more of these kind of golden orange colors that are also evocative, pick up on the sunset. And here you're just seeing the sunscreen and you're seeing the pavilion in context, but in a minute we'll come back to these kind of colors that draw people in. Here you are, you're inside the pavilion, so now you're looking out to the park and you can see more what I'm talking about. And the idea is that like these other spaces, this isn't only to sort of passively walk through architecturally, but it's really for the community to fill the space with their dreams and desires and ceremonies and performances. So here you see some people kind of walking into this space as though it's a lobby. But here's another iteration, which is a performance as part of a wedding. And so we're trying to create these series of little hearts around the city that people can embrace and make their own, and that can be distinctive and creative and continue sort of very specific moments of heritage into the present. Thank you.